told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough.
Disrespectful during the song, I'd let you sit up here, but you were. So, bye. You too.
Yeah, that's right.
Let's start off with a word of prayer. And Father, we just come to your precious holy name of Jesus again to thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. God, there's so much going on and so much fear in this land, and God, you are the one that can conquer all this. And God, I just know you've already set things in motion. My heart just feels and knows that you have heard the cries of your people, and things are going to change here real soon. And I just thank you for this shakening, this awakening of your church and of your people, that that again, the harvest is plenty, but the workers are few, and that you will fire up the hearts of the people that are following you and just stir their hearts to see that your time of your son is coming, and is coming very quickly, and then that we should prepare and also think about those that are around us, our family members and our friends that are lost, that this is the time. This is the time to stand up and speak and be bold and to share your love, share the gospel of your love for them, that salvation shall come to them, because today is the day of salvation. God, I love you. Jesus, I love you. Holy Spirit, I love you. I ask now that you will hide me behind the cross. And they do not see me, but they see you, Jesus. And Holy Spirit, again, just hold my tongue, what needs to be not said, and speak what needs to be said to lift up the name of Jesus. And then everything that is done and here today, that will be honor and glory to you in the precious holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, today we're going to do a little something different. It's kind of to ask you this question. How many of you, at some point in your life, you've been dissatisfied with your behavior? You've been dissatisfied in what you do or what you've done, your choices that you make. How many of you ever been there? Been there, done that? You kind of just have the regrets, you know? Yeah, I know that I should have never cheated on that test. I should have listened to the teacher and went to in school, so, you know, silent lunch, you know, or I should have done what my boss told me to and turned that report in on time instead of, you know, sitting around the coffee pot gossiping, you know, and telling the stories about, you know, what's his name and her, you know. I mean, it's like, you know, some of us, we really look and reflect on ourselves, on our behaviors, and we do have some regrets. And then that, give me a thing of water real quick, Jaden.
Yeah. Cool. Thank you.
And in that, I just feel that there's a lot of things in our lives that we just, we're just dissatisfied with our lives. So we're sitting back and having some regrets of the things that we've chosen to do. And in that, it's to sit back. And, because right now I see a lot of people, because of this, what's going on, it's giving them time to sit in their homes, cutting down on the things that they're allowed to do, you know, the things that you can go out to. I mean, the basic places that you can go, Walmart, get groceries, or Food Lion, get groceries, or Save a Lot, get groceries, you know, all these to get groceries, and right back home and work around the house. But I'm going to tell you what, Lowe's, business is up because everybody got nothing else to do but to go get something to fix around the house. That's okay. You know, that's kind of good for Lowe's, but, you know, and in there, they're trying to accommodate also the things that are going on. They're shutting down early as well as so many other stores. So to look at this problem that we're kind of sitting around and we're thinking about our lives because in this fear of death that's all around us, it's like, what kind of person am I? Well, what's going on in my life? Is there something that that I've got to look at? Like, I think God is trying to speak to me, but I don't know what's going on. It's like, I don't know where I'm going to go. What happens if I do get this virus and I do die? Or what happens if my friends get this virus, or my children, or my loved one, or my spouse, or, you know, my best friend? What happens? What is God trying to say in this mayhem and in this thing? And then now I look at it, what kind of person am I saying that I'm a Christian, or maybe I'm not a Christian? And my behavior, my actions towards those around me. Because look, some of us, we're going to look at each other, you know what, just like we started off the year, you know, we're going to always make up those little things, I'm going to go on a diet, you know, and we're going to start working out, and 3 weeks later, and never happened. We bought the gym membership, and in February we turned around and canceled it because we never made it. We're just throwing $20 out the window every month, you know, for that membership. You know, so it's like we make all these things we want to do to change ourselves. We even think about ourselves like, you know what, I'm going to quit cussing. We're going to try to put good morals on us. You know, I'm going to try to get involved in church. Oh, I just go to start. I was just thinking about going to church, and then all of a sudden this coronavirus comes along there, and all the churches are shut down.
Good excuse.
Good excuse. I like that. It's a good excuse. You see, religious behavior, you can put that up on the screen, religious behavior can make you a nice person. But only Christ can make you a new person. And in that, the new person is what really takes the long term of your behavior and makes it worth the while. Here's where I get this from. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 16 and 17. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16 and 17 says this. At one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. And so that what he's saying right here is a lot of people kind of like, Jesus is a good person. He was an awesome prophet. Well, some of the stories I heard about him being able to heal people, amazing dude. That's the human point of view. How differently we know him now. Verse 17, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Now, catch this real quick here in this verse 17. He's saying that the change is coming. He says this means anyone who belongs to Christ. Here's the issue. Many of us have not changed because we just believe in Christ. Check this out. The demons also believe in Christ because when Jesus walked the earth, they believed in him so much and said, please don't throw us out into the abyss. At least give us a chance and throw us into the pigs. We may be able to survive and maybe hop from the pigs back onto another person. They didn't tell Jesus that, but in their reply of saying, don't throw us out into the abyss, because they knew the power of Jesus Christ. They believed that he was the Son of God. They knew it. But they didn't belong to him. That's what that verse says. There it says that the means anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. That how many of us maybe that in our lives, in our sayings, we kind of look at ourselves and say, well, you know what? I did ask Jesus to save me, but in that I'm just I'm still getting high during the week. I'm still drinking and getting drunk and through the week. I still cuss like the sailor that I was. You know, I still treat people bad. And I have this bad attitude. You know, I give my mom and dad a hard time just when they tell me just to clean my room. I just go, you know, I heard you already, you know. And it's throwing something. You know, you just got this bad character and attitude that's always lingering and coming out of you. Because again, what's in your heart comes out your mouth. And what comes out your mouth is your character of what's in your heart. See, if you knew me a long time ago, from my understanding, you know, with the pictures that I had from my mom and dad, is I got saved when I was probably about 5. Because that was about the pictures that they had me getting baptized. But if I sit down there and I talk to you of the stories of my life, I would say to you, I wasn't saved. Because when I was 10, my dad was taking me and my brother to the police station. What? Yeah, because what happened was me and my buddy Dave, you know, my next door neighbor, we used to hang out all the time, and we used to go around and do a lot of stuff, and we used to go and we used to, see, back in the day, you guys remember when they had the glass bottles and you can take them to the store and get like 5 cents, 10 cents, 25 cents. You know, you could. No, yeah. Oh, you don't even know nothing about that, you know. Oh, I don't know. We're about 10 years old. We go, but we found out where certain houses were that had those bottles stored up so they could take them to the store and get some money back to pay towards their groceries or buy some more sodas, you know, or whatever it was, you know. So, but we would help ourselves in gathering up them in bags and take them down to the store and turn those in and get money, and we would be able to buy some chips and candy and things like that. But on our way out the door, as we'd done purchased some things, we were also helping ourselves and putting stuff in our pockets as we walked out the door. Well, one Sunday morning after church, glory, hallelujah, as we had a drug problem back in the day, you know, mom and dad took us to church, but then it was afterwards, we must have get on mom and dad's nerves. It was time to go to our room, and you know, even at 10 or 11 years old, it's time to lay down and rest for a little bit. You know, because mom and dad need a break, you know. So in that, all of a sudden, here comes dad, and he starts asking, he starts bringing these, you know, what those, what's the, they know, they ask you the question, but they know the answer.
Which one?
Huh? rhetorical question.
Yeah, that was.
I do that a lot. It's the rhetorical question. And so he starts asking those questions in here to find out that he done had the information of that. There was this pile of stuff found in the cornfield right next door to us. And in that, it was like, where'd you get this from? Well, you know, me and Dave, you know, and we just did this and did this, and that just all come out. And next thing you know, we didn't got our punishment of getting the swat with the paddle, you know, and then get in the station wagon, and we were on the road. Where are we going, Dad? Where are we going? You'll see when we get there. And we pulled right up to the police station. But many more stories like that. From the time of 5 until, it was like almost 30 years old, that I can tell you the bad things that I've done, especially with my 20s. Them are not nice stories. You know the stories where you're driving in your Hot Wheel, your nice, I had a Trans Am, 73 Trans Am, jacked up, big wheels, nice thing, was powerful. Pull up to the stoplight, pulls up a nice Chevelle, pull up beside me, boom, 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 okay, you want to race, let's do this, and break the speed limit, drag racing down the road, you know, next thing you know, here comes the police, they turn around, start chasing us, you know, and then you're trying to weave in and out of and hide, you know, and get into a nice little parking area, you know, turn off the lights. It was kind of cool that I had a black car that was able to just pull right into a driveway, turn all the lights off, turn the motor off, and then watch them drive right by. You think that was just in the movies. It wasn't in the movies, you know. And so it's the things that you look at your life and say, was I really a Christian? Was I really one that said, I follow Jesus Christ? Or was it just, I believe in Jesus, but I didn't belong to Jesus? That was where I was going with that. Until the day that I came into the conviction of in a hotel room, reading his words, and all of us saying, I love you, but you have sinned against me. Repent of your sins. Come and belong to me. Follow me. Let all that way of living go and follow me. And then that day is when I turned my life over and said, I'm in. I'm all in. And I'm turning all this stuff and I'm letting go of all that sinful life and I'm walking away from it. See what happens when you know who you are in Christ, you are a new person. Your behavior as a new person changes. And in that, when you become this new person, it's like you treat people different. Because in my understanding of that, here's where I'm coming across at. That so there's so many awesome churches around here. They should be filled to the max and overflowing. But in that, somehow or another, it seems as though they get these little clicks going on and they get it in their mindset just because I'm following Christ and I'm this good person, I'm better than you. And in that, we shun people away, or we treat people a certain way, or we snub our noses in a way just because of the way they dress, look, they have their tattoos or their earrings. They got their piercings here and here and here and here. And I ain't going no farther with that. You know, and so it's that to sit back and say, you know, because you look like that, you just stay right over there. We ain't going to have nothing to do with you. Now, the preacher and the leader, he's probably all in there. He's probably the only one to walk over there and love on them and introduce them or get them a cup of coffee and help them find a place to sit. But that's sad. It shouldn't be that way. It should be the whole church should be overwhelming them with such love and care. That everyone that walks through the door of the church everywhere across this United States should be welcome. I have this one pastor that he kind of mentors me, and in his story was about this one couple that came in there, and they went straight to the pastor and said, you know, hey, we just want to know what kind of church you have here, and to know if we will be welcome here. And I'm like, yeah, sure. He goes, well, here's a little bit more added to this. Our daughter is pregnant outside of marriage. Now, are we still welcome here? He said, absolutely. Now, this is the kind of church that I want to be like. That as that they welcomed her, even though that the sin choices that she made was wrong, They loved her where she was. And in loving her where she was, she turned around and found Jesus and fell in love with Jesus and got saved. From that point on where she got saved, she had her baby. Then from after she had her baby, she met her husband-to-be. Then the story goes from there. And she's like, look, dude, this is an awesome story, because it doesn't stop there that she meets her husband. They get married. They live happily ever after. No, no. They turn around and he gets deployed because he's a military man. And they have to leave the church. But in that, they still stay in connection with the church. And then so much away, she gets her friends to watch the church services online with her. They turn around because they were local and she's far away now. She's like, well, go to the church. Just go to the church. You'll love it. They go to the church and they get saved. They turn around and from that getting saved, they turn around and started volunteering in the children's church. And it doesn't stop there. The woman so falls in love with Jesus that she turns around and becomes a youth pastor at the church on base or where she's at with her husband serving our United States. See, to welcome that pregnant girl in and saying, I love you where you are, changes everything. Because here's what Jesus says. Here's what we're looking at. Luke chapter 14, verse 13 says this. Luke chapter 14, verse 13. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. You know what will change our lives? You know what will change this church's life? You know what will change your church's life? Because many of you are being able to watch because your church couldn't. Across the country, no churches are, if you've got more than 10, you're not supposed to assemble according to what the law is trying to run across. Some of the churches are being brave and they're doing a church. The majority of them, 98% of them across this country, they're doing online services. But what will bless and change your life is to accept what Jesus is saying here. The poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. The less fortunate ones, the ones with the tattoos, the ones with the earrings, the ones that are living together. Even though the ones that are gay or lesbian, the ones that are they're shacking up with their boyfriends and girlfriends, to when they come in, they're not to be judging them right off the bat. Well, you're a sinner. You need Jesus and jumping down the door. They know what they are. They know where they're at. It is not our place to judge. Our place is to love and let the judgment come from God and the Holy Spirit. And in that word and speaking the truth in love, it says, look, I love you where you're at, but understand this is what God's word says right here. And I'm just going to tell you in God's word is that kind of immorality or that kind of lying or that kind of stealing or that kind of sexual perversion is going to bring consequences to you. And it's like you're seeing them in this house. It's on fire. I talked about this last week. You see them in this house. It's on fire. And you're saying, I don't want you to burn up. I want to save your life. So in that, I'm going to come in here and I'm going to wrap my arms around you and hug you and carry you out of the fire. And how many people need that hug, need that love, need that insurance of saying, you have a purpose, but the only fulfillment of that purpose is first is to be saved, to know Jesus Christ, to turn your life over to Him. And the only way that happens is if we ourselves invest in other people's lives and invite them to church. Jesus invited those people in. He even kind of like, it's like a TV series, but they got their own little TV thing. It's called The Chosen. And I kind of caught a brief glimpse of one of the shows, and I think I'm going to go ahead and get on this thing and watch the eight. It's like a series of eight right now. And one of them is he meets the guy named Matthew, who is a tax collector. And in that, Matthew's like, he's doing his job, and he's over there, and Jesus is like, you know, I'm calling you, Matthew, to come follow me. And Peter's over there like, dude, do you not know this dude is a, he's a fact booker. He's a thief. He's like the worst guy. He's the lowest of low. You go about shepherds is low, and here's tax collectors way down here. You know, it's like, you know, and then as they're walking off, and Matthew's just so intrigued that Jesus confronted him and loved him where he was and invited him to come along on the journey, that he said, you know what? He goes, we're going to have a party tonight. He goes, oh yeah, where are we going to? And Jesus says, we're going to your house, Matthew, and you're hosting it. You know, it's like, how is it that you turn around and reject those that are the lowest of love, where Jesus is saying, love them, hug them, carry them, and just bring them along on the trip? And Jesus and the Holy Spirit, they're the ones that are going to change them. You're going to see the difference. You're going to see that happen. You see, God accepts you as you are. But he will never leave you as you are. Let me say that again. God accepts you as you are, but he will never leave you as you are. I think back at even my time of 1998, and my life was just wrecked. Wrecked. I was going through a divorce. I just didn't know where I was, like, spiraling down. To me, that's when I got saved. And my life is just spiraling out of control. I lost everything. I mean, for there was a short bit of time that all I had was the clothes on my back and a truck and my work truck. That was it. I didn't even have it somewhere. I spent the night in my truck, you know, I didn't have nowhere to live. And then it's like the proof of God's love just continues. I just say, you know what? I'm following you, God, no matter where. And if I get to stay in this truck for however long, I'm, you know, just help me. Just show me the way. To be able to run into a guy at a softball game, and he like, I want to help you out. Now, how many times that God brings somebody into your life, and they're down on their luck? The devil's got them down, and he's trying to hold their head under the water, that they're gonna just choke and die out and give up life. That they cross your path at this time in their life, and you're just like, I'm sorry, I can't help you. My hands are tied. We're all on lockdown because of the coronavirus. So, you know, hey. That God opened the door from there to give me a place to live. That he turned around and gave me hope and changing to be able to find to answer my prayers, to be invited to a different church. And from that invitation is where I turned around and met my wife. I was like, at first when I met her, I was like, there's no hope, there's no way. That girl is way beautiful. I ain't got a chance. But she fit for. It was definitely God's grace and his love for me to say, oh, you're going to love that ugly mug, you know.
Ugly mug.
He broke and ugly, and at the same time, he's going to turn around and he's going to take good care of you because I'm going to take care of him. There's hope. To change your life, to be a new person, to create this life, purpose life that he has for you. Isaiah chapter 43 verse 19 says this. Isaiah 43:19. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wastelands. Look, this shaking that's happening right now, Lord, here it comes, the Holy Spirit. Was it not sometime last year that God really predicted some things were going to happen here? Yes. Yes. There was a shaking to the Christians. God said there's going to be a shaking to the Christians. For us not right now, quit being afraid. For many of you, there's going to be a new direction out of all of this. It's already thinking, you're like, well, I just lost my job. I got to, no. You're being positioned to a different job. You're being positioned. God's positioning you. Everything's going to straighten out. I know it. I just know it. Some of you, here we go. Relationships. There's a shakening in relationships. I'm already seeing it, one in my house. One of the foster daughters in there, and I just knew it was coming, it happened, and now she had nowhere to live, and she's back at my house. You know, it's not Jesse. Jesse's my daughter. Let's get that straight, okay? Jesse's my daughter. Yeah, this is a foster daughter.
And okay? I still live in my own house.
Jesse's got her own. God's doing awesome things with Jesse and providing for her, taking care of her. He's just doing an amazing job. But it's not just her. There's many, many relationships that are happening, and I'm feeling it. The Spirit of God is in the midst of it. There's a marriage couple that they're going through right now, and it's just shaking. And you know, and what it's doing, I'm watching this man that from this shaking go so close to God that now before he was asking me, what do you think God's saying in all of this? That now he's hearing God because of the shaking, and then that it's pulling him closer. That now he hears the voice of God. That he's saying, you just keep strong, you keep doing what you're doing, I'll take care of your wife. But some of you you're in relationship and you're being tugged back and forth, you know, and the true matter is what happens is that you end up in relationships that are unequally yoked, and then that because, I hear you, Lord. That he's saying you're in relationships that are unequally yoked, and you're just disobeying God, and he's saying, you know, you need to break off of this relationship, but you're struggling. Why you're struggling is because you created a soul tie. It's more for so for women because emotionally, women get tied to men because it's just the way you're created. And emotions what creates it. And then if you turn around and have sex to add to it, then you're outside of that. It creates a greater bond. Now it makes it harder for you to. And then if you're living with them, it creates it harder because now you're financially established by them. And then that night, and God's doing a shaking and saying, I want something better for you. I want something better for you. I love you. Please get out of this relationship. Run. It's toxic. It's going to kill you. Run. God is making a way for you to get out. Where there doesn't seem to be a way, I, God, makes a way. That's what he said. I make a way. How many of you ever seen Blue's Clues? You ever seen Blue's Clues? You ever seen Blue's Clues? Yeah, I know you guys have seen Blue's Clues. You ever notice how that, what is it, what's that little song that they sing there? You just got a letter.
Yeah, you just got a letter. You just got a letter.
Yep. He's got it. So in that, but you kind of never notice how that sometimes when they're going through there, because I've seen this a few times, you know, all of a sudden they're trying to find a way out, and they just jump right into a painting. Yeah. Right. And they find a different way. They find a different way because they jump to their painting. Or they'll have a chalk, and they'll draw a door, and they'll open the door and go through the door.
Escape.
What if God is doing something like that for you? He's made this door for you to walk through. And you're standing at the door and you're doubting going through the door. You're afraid because what you had, I love that. I love that person. I love that person. I loved her. I loved him. But God's saying, go through the door. I made a door, go through the door. And you're freaking out. But I'm telling you, when you belong to Jesus, even when you didn't mean to make a wrong choice, even when you made the wrong choice or didn't mean to make the wrong choice, he still all of a sudden he gets involved in there and he gets you back over where you belong. He gets you out of the mess because I'm just right there. Speaking to three different women and saying, oh, crud. Lord, I think I messed up here. Help me up. They're good women. I'm not saying nothing. They are. They're really awesome. They're going to make awesome. They're going to make awesome. They just love Jesus so much. But for what God said to do and to go, I heard his voice very clearly. He said, go this way. I said, what about And he said, go. And I'm like, oh, okay. And now I'm standing at another door. And I'm looking at this door that he created. And I'm just like, it reminded me of another door that I walked through many years ago. And I was afraid to go through that door. But this one here, I'm feeling a little bit bolder. I'm feeling a little bit stronger. And I got my hand on the knob, and I'm ready to walk through. What about you? Do you trust God with your life? And now you're in this position of being still a little bit more. God's trying to get your attention. You have to stay home a little bit more. Are we so glued to the TV, or we're so glued to playing video games? Are we so turned around that we're missing out on God saying, I got you still for a little bit while. Look at what I got to say, because we're going to go a different direction. And if you don't pay attention, you're going to miss out on the glory. Because I'm going to tell you what, there's glory coming. There's a move of God coming. And there's going to be a lot of people saved from what's fixing to happen here. As soon as all this passes, and it's going to pass, by the blood of Jesus Christ, the celebration of His death and resurrection, that day the blood is applied, this will pass. And the economy will go right back up, and things will get good in our lives, and what will we do? Will we do like we did in 9/11? It's all good. Let's go back to life as normal. Or will we see the urgent need that Jesus Christ is coming sooner than we think? And life is precious. And get so on fire for Jesus that we become the new person that He wants us to be. And His Word says that we are to be holy as He is holy. And we start putting down the things that are sin in our lives. The idols we've created, this God that we've created to say that this kind of living is okay because God's okay, He loves me. Yes, He loves you, but He said, sin is sin. And you need to stop it. You need to repent. You need to move away from it and leave it go. Walk away. And in that, He's going to move you. He's doing it here. Next week, we're moving. Woo-hoo. We're getting out of this building. We're moving down the street. We're going to 1709 West C Street in Kannapolis. Right down there. If you go by where we're at, where Old Ollie's Ice Cream is, that's where we go. Right there is YMCA. You pass the YMCA, you'll see where we were, Old Ollie's Ice Cream. Drive on down. We're going down the street and on the left. We'll be in a little fenced-in area. It used to be a hardware store. And then... 425
was there.
God's presence is in that place. I'm telling you. It's going to be amazing. You need to go. When we move down there, you need to get down there. If you don't go to church, you don't belong to a church, you need to get down there because there's a new thing happening. And it's starting by us moving. Sometimes it takes you to move out of where you're at. Move out of the relationship. Move out of move out of mom and dad's house. Get your own place. If you're a man, you're watching, can't take care of your wife when you're going to get married to in your mom and dad's house. Just can't happen. Moving to a new place. And for some of you, okay. God, well, you're my place. I hear you, Lord. I hear you. The wedding bells are ringing, and you're moving out from where you're at to a new place.
He talking about y'all, because I still got a couple more months on my lease.
But the thing about it is still not to lose focus of the new you, to turn around and share that with somebody else. I remember being a bus driver at two different churches, and it never changed from the point of that the mission that God had me do was get behind the wheel. I tried to go door to door to knock on people's houses and invite the children to get on the bus. I never got one child to get on the bus. Not one. But I'm going to tell you what happened.
I be driving down a truck, stop, pick up a kid. We start driving down the little road. I go, John, stop. I go, what's going on? Everything about you? We're going to ask these kids right here playing in the front yard. They want to go to church. And I'm like, okay, go right ahead. They throw the windows down. Everybody from one side of the bus go to the other side of the bus, you know. If they were big kids, we probably would have went like this, you know. But, you know, it didn't happen that way. But they were all hollering out there, hey, you guys, you know, go to church with us. And they were like, yeah, let's ask our mom. And they turn around and say, sissy, go with us down there and ask if they can go to church with us. And next thing you know, I've got four more kids climbing up on the bus. Just even that to invite children, and children turn around and invite children, you know, children. Okay, thank you for the vision, Lord. The children ministry here is going to take off when we get down here. You all just better get ready. And if you love children, you better get involved with this ministry, because I'm going to tell you what, I don't know what's happened. I just know Jesus said children are going to do it.
Oh, my kids.
Children are going to do it. Because here's another story. I got another story because I was hurting this one because of My buddy, my coworker, he was so excited that his daughter wanted to get baptized. But now because of this virus, the baptismal service was canceled. You know, so in that he's kind of bummed, you know, about it. And I says, don't worry about it. He goes, yeah, but she's so excited. She's inviting everybody, you know, and I don't know, but that's too many people to come. I said, no. Let her invite everybody, because here's a story that I heard this one preacher tell him. He said, this 6-year-old little girl, she invited 50 people to come watch her get baptized. 40 of those people came to watch. 4 of those had quit church because church was just, it was too religious and too much stuff going on. You know, Christians hating Christians, and it was like, I'm out, you know. And in that, the Word of God spoke to them to get back involved in church. Then their children turned around and got saved. Then there's this effect, you know, this happened and that happened. And just like, it's like another group of people got baptized just because one girl invited 40 people to watch her get baptized. And countless lives were changed. John chapter 1, verse 45 and 46 says this. Philip found Nathan and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nazareth? Can anything good come from there? That's the hole in the wall. You know, he's just like, that's the nastiest place. Nothing good comes from there, Nazareth. And Nathanael asks, "Come see," said Philip. "Come see," said Philip. You want to see the move of God is going to happen when we move down there? Come see, because I'm telling you, just even now that I see the visions that he's given me, that there's going to be people healed. There's going to be countless people's lives changed. Well, it's the new thing God's doing. We get down there, there's a new move of God coming, and it's going to change. It's going to change countless of lives. There's going to be an online presence that you're going to get saved and healed online. It's going to be amazing. It's just everything that I'm seeing. He's saying, just stay faithful. Just stay faithful. Be obedient. Stay faithful. Be obedient. Come see. Maybe you have a church and you just quit going to it. Well, I'm going to tell you what. This move of God ain't just for us. It's for all kinds of places going to get this. Maybe you need to go back and visit your church and go see. Go see what's going to happen over there. It's going to go across this country. From the East Coast to the West Coast, there's going to be a move of the Holy Spirit. God is going to pour down on all flesh. His word of prophecy of what he prophesied, the move of God is coming one good last time. Then we see Jesus is coming. We done talked about the prophecy. When these bad stuff happen, it's not the end yet. But it's come. All this has happened has prepared the system. It prepared the worldwide system to prepare for the Antichrist to step in and say, "Shut her down, guys." And every one of us will be in martial law, stuck in our homes. See how easy it is to get us all stuck in our homes? It's all lining up.
I was already stuck in my home.
But in all this, to be a new person, you first must be born again. There's this guy, his name was Nicodemus. He kind of snuck out at night to go see Jesus and ask him some questions. That's where we kind of get that Nick at night.
I'm sure that's not where they got that.
As long as one of you was going to catch on to that one, you know. But Nicodemus, he was a Pharisee. He was a church guy. He was the preacher. He's kind of like a preacher kind of guy, you know. And in that, he wanted to see this Jesus at night, you know, because there's something about him. If I go confront him and ask him these things in the day, it might go against my character. It might cause me troubles at my church, you know. And, you know, how many of us, we don't want no troubles at our church. We don't want no troubles upon ourselves. We have enough troubles as it is. So we're going to do some things at night. You know, if you're afraid to share Jesus, I really question your relationship with him. But here's what, let's just move on to this. In John chapter 3, verse 3, says this. We're going to read 3 through 7. John chapter 3, we're going to read 3 through 7. It says this. As Nicodemus is going to him and he's talking about this, about getting saved, you know, and something like this is in reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Born again. Verse 4, how can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born. And Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh is given birth to flesh. That's where a husband and wife come together. They create a baby, and the baby's born of the flesh. That's what he's meaning there. But the Spirit gives birth to a spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. See, what he's referring to is there's an understanding that when you die, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you don't repent of your sins, you're going to die twice. You're going to die a physical death, and then you're going to be judged, and then you're going to die a spiritual death. And in that spiritual death, you're going to go to a place that's called hell. It's not meant for you. It was created for Satan and his evil demons and fallen angels. But in that, because you rejected the salvation, the love, the mercy, the grace that he has bestowed upon us, you rejected that relationship, you choose then that choice, the consequences is the second death, eternity in hell. And in that, Jesus is saying, you don't have to die the second death. And in that, you have to be born. So in this, you can be born twice and only die once. The first birth is born again is that you've been delivered by your mom, but then the second one is that you see Jesus Christ, that he's the only way to heaven, and that you repent of your sin, and then that you're born a new person. The old has passed away, that you become this new person. So to really get into your face and to say at this time, this craziness of life, that you turn around and just judge yourself in a minute in your own heart, in your own mind, and say, I do this wrong, I do this wrong, I do this wrong. Am I really born again? Am I a new person? If I die today because of this virus, or if I die today because somebody was scared they got the virus and they were texting somebody, I have to go to the doctor because and they crossed the line and hit you head on and killed you in the car, would you go to heaven because you were born again? Or would you're so much set that you did not repent of your sins and belong to Jesus Christ? Remember the scriptures we read earlier? He said that those that belong to him. So many of us are walking around saying we're Christians because we believe in Jesus Christ, but we don't belong to Jesus Christ. We're just this fakeness going on about us. We're the fake Christians. I go to church every Sunday, It was Friday and Saturday. We're sitting there drinking our beer, smoking our pot, and cussing up our storms, and watching our dirty movies, and we're also being ugly to our children, and our children are being ugly to us, and we're just, it's just a hate-love relationship going on all around us. You know, and so it's, as I say, are you truly saved? Are you truly born again? Maybe some of us, you just need to renew your faith. You need to renew your relationship with. You walked away. You made some choices. You got involved in something. You got involved with somebody. You got involved in that you made some bad choices. And then that now you need to repent of it and get back away from it. Because again, His word is very clear. He's saying He wants you to be holy as He is holy. A higher standard. He's setting a higher standard for us. Because the world is in a dark place right now, and He needs you as the light. He needs me as the light to shine bright and say, hope is this way. Hope is the cross. Hope is Jesus. Come, 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 come see. Come see. Just like Philip. Come see. Come see Jesus. So as we close, I challenge you, self-examine yourself where you're at. That today you'll have the choice and the knowledge and the understanding to know you have been born again, that you belong to Jesus Christ. But for you today that you're sitting there and you have doubts in that, today you can have assurance. You can have assurance to be born again that you belong to Jesus, and that if life hits you, because I'm telling you, when you go to this book, go to the end of Revelations, because this is just the preset. This virus is just the setting. Because there's still things that in Revelation, it starts off with four horses. There's famine that's going to come, and a lot of people are going to die of starvation. There's a death that's going to come, and a lot of people are going to die of death because of these more viruses and different viruses. There's death coming because of the rules. There's just so much coming. There's so much death coming. And are you going to be a part of the dead that will die and go to hell? Or are you going to be part of the dead that you're going to be victory in Jesus and saying, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. I know that killed me on the earth, but I'm here in the presence of Jesus Christ and bowing to Him because He saved my soul. That prediction is yet still to come, and it's coming fast. Are you ready? And if you're not ready and you want to be saved today, we're going to pray a prayer and you can be saved today and become that new person. As we close, if you all bow your hands. First, directed the prayer to the believers. Again, you are the chosen ones. You are the ones that say, you know what? My garment is dirty. I'm a little bit messed up there. I need to get back into where God needs me to be. I need to repent of that. I need the power. I need to not walk in fear. I need to conquer a lot of some things in my life. Today is the day to say, step in, God. Let's make this change and make me a new person. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the precious holy name of Jesus to give you all the praise and honor and glory. Forgive me of my sins, of creating a God that you are not that God. You are a just God. You are a good God. You are a loving God. You are a purposeful God that created us for purpose to honor you and lift up the name of Jesus. Forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of making idols. And Father, forgive me of my sexual immorality. Forgive me of the lusting. And forgive me of the sins of lying. Forgive me of the sins of doubt. Forgive me of the sins of worry. God, forgive me of anything that is in me that is against you, Jesus, and you, Father. Forgive me. Wash me with the blood of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, come upon me with a new baptism from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. Just wash through me. To lead me to holiness. To get my garments ready for Jesus to come. To crack that sky and call us forth to the banquet. To be a light in a dark place. Forgive me. cleanse me. I repent of these sins in the name of Jesus. I love you. For those today, that today is the day that they if I die, they don't know where they're going to go, or they know they ain't going to heaven. God, that they will pray with me this prayer of salvation, that they will become a new person and belong to you, Jesus Christ, saying, Father, I believe Jesus Christ died on the cross, and you raised him from the dead to be my payment for my sins. So I'm asking forgiveness of my sins. Washed and clean. Make me a new person. Baptize me with your Holy Spirit. Change me from the inside out. I believe and I follow you, and I make Jesus my Lord of my life today, right now. In Jesus' name. Hear their prayer of salvation. Give them courage to just message somebody or message us. Reach out to us, Lord, in the comments. And just say, I did it. I believed. I asked him some kind of way. And just tell them. Because you, Jesus, you said if anyone does that, that you, Jesus, would say their name to the Father. Man, what an awesome way to be mentioned. My name coming out of Jesus' mouth. How amazing. Father, I love you. Jesus, I love you. As we move forward from this shaking that's happened across this earth, that you're preparing us for a move of your Holy Spirit. The laborers are few, Father, and we need some laborers. The harvest is plenty, and you will bring the harvest, that we will be ready for the harvest. Precious holy name of Jesus, I bless these people here, and I bless them that are watching online, that you will again reveal, give them the victory of over the war that's going on, the spiritual war that's going on in their lives, of financial or relationships, and even the spiritual war that's going on in their minds of depression. And you will just right now that, oh, there's two people that are on here right now that God is saying to you, he knows you're battling that depression, and he's saying, just cry out to me and then speak to that spirit right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I speak to you, depression. I bind you in the name of Jesus, and I curse you, and I cast you off of those two women right now in the name of Jesus, and I cast you into the Atlantic Ocean right now. Get out, get out, get out. You have no right with them no longer, because they belong to Jesus. And I cover you with the blood and the righteousness of Jesus Christ and his peace. Peace, spirit of peace, come upon them right now. Spirit of peace, come upon them right now. In Jesus' precious holy name. Father, we bind now the spirit of fear in our lives. Fear, I speak to you in the name of Jesus, by his blood and by his righteousness. We bind you and we cast you off of us, out of our house, out of our jobs, out of our minds. Get out. You have no right to the people of God. You have no right to whisper in their ears nothing. You have no right to touch them. You have no right to mess with them. In the name of Jesus, I proclaim the blood and the righteousness of all your people. In Jesus' name, that you are free from fear right now. I speak boldness and courage upon you right now. In the precious holy name of Jesus, you are blessed with courage. In Jesus' name. God, I love you. Holy Spirit, I thank you. Thank you for speaking to me. Thank you for allowing me to pass this on to your people. We love you so much. Bless them all. Everyone that hears these words, stand in the words of Isaiah. These words will go forth and they will accomplish things whereunto it is sent. In Jesus Christ's holy name, I proclaim it. Amen, amen. Dismissed.
Come on. Pass the skating.